I am the co-chairperson, along with Farah Habib, of the Multicultural Committee here at Bristol Community College. This is the last multicultural event of our semester, so I'm glad you're here. And this, I didn't tell you the truth, I know I'm biased, but I think it's going to be the best. Yes, because we've got veteran, BCC student veterans who have experienced overseas culture while they were in the military, and now they're here, and they're going to BCC. And they're going to tell us about their experiences and how their perception of being in different cultures. Very enlightening. And that's what the Multicultural Committee is all about learning about other people's cultures and how we might all get along better. So that's what's going to happen today. Let me see. It's also Veterans Day tomorrow, so this is really a privilege for us today to have John Savage, who is in the Army, and Brian Rose, who is in the Navy, be here, that we can honor them for giving their service to us in the United States, to helping to protect us. And what else? We're going to see through the eyes of a veteran, that's the name of this program, about their diverse experiences. I have an evaluation sheet that has been given out to you by one of my students, I believe. At the end of the session, will you please either hand it back to her, where are you, Abigail? Either her, or me, or Judy. Judy, just raise your hand. Just make sure that we get them back, please. And this is going to be an interactive event, so you can certainly ask questions as we're going along. And then Beth Messina is here also. Will you want to just stand up for a second, Beth? Who is in charge of our veterans services here at Bristol Community College. And she's going to have some things to say after the event as well.
Yep.
Okay, all right, thank you. Please help me welcome John. Now I'm going to get us started by asking John and Brian to answer a couple of questions, and then we'll see where that takes us, okay? So to begin with, both of you were overseas in different places, different parts of the military. What was your first experience going into another country? Brian, what about you? Let's start with you first.
Is this on? I spent most of my time, I was in the Navy, I was on a ship in Japan for the most part. We traveled around a lot. But my first experience was landing in Tokyo Airport, and Japanese culture and American culture are so different.
That was one of the first things that struck me as different, yeah.
Everyone was so friendly, especially at the airport, which was funny. Whenever I came home, I would fly into Boston. I knew I was in America the second I landed, just because of like the way people treated you. But
really?
Yeah, so maybe that's the first thing.
Friendly, and what would they offer you? Smile.
Well, when people are at work, they're extremely professional, helpful, even something that we might consider like a job that you don't like very much, you know. So that's one of the first things I noticed was how professional and helpful everybody was in the airport.
So that must have kind of given you somewhat of a feeling of security, right? That you were going into a friendly area.
Yes, I mean, I couldn't read any of the signs at first. Like, it's a big culture shock.
Because the language, you couldn't.
For me, my first experience was 1986. I went to the Sinai Peninsula in Egypt. Didn't really get to meet a lot of the Egyptians or the first off, because I was kind of assigned to the base. I didn't get to meet. They had some of them that worked on the base. Talked with a few of them, but didn't really get to any type of interaction with them. After leaving the base and going to a different outpost. You would see some of the people, the natives or the Bedouins, that they would call them, is what they called them then, because they were like nomadic tribes that just kind of bounced around the Sinai Peninsula. But
what
they
did it look like the climate and all of that? Getting off the plane, what was it like to go into this new country?
We flew into, if anybody's been paying attention to current events, you know the Russian plane that was blown up. That plane actually flew out of the place in Egypt where I was flew into. It's called Sharm el-Sheikh. When I first landed there in 1986, it was desolate. There was nothing there. There was no resorts, no nothing. However, I returned there in 2004, and it is it's a different place. It's completely built up. A lot of countries, Italy, France, Russia, they all have major resorts there. But it's just, you know, they're very different type of people there. That culture, the Middle East culture and everything, they're very, you know, it's
different in what way, John? And what about the language as well?
The language, they try to give you, the military, you know, obviously for me, with the, you know, and like with Brian, you know, they try to give you, immerse you into some of the language and the culture and things like that. They try to teach you a little bit of Arabic. You know, I've also been to Afghanistan. They try to teach you a little bit of Pashto and Dari, which, you know, it's almost next to impossible unless you're very good at languages in the first place to pick it up. You can pick up a little conversational pieces, but that's as far as it gets.
Like hello.
Hello and everything. The thing that I noticed about, and you know, but a lot of Americans don't like people to get up close to them and everything, you know, and get, you know, they don't like the touchy-feely type of stuff. Well, the Middle Eastern culture, that's the way they get very close to you. They embrace you, they hug you, you know, the kissing, when they first meet you. It's not, you know, they're not falling in love with you. That's just their culture. That's how they deal with you. And you have to get by that. You can't, like, push them away. Because you push them away, you offend them.
Is that true in Japan as well?
I would say America, we probably have the widest.
Yeah, we're very
personal space.
Yeah,
even other European countries, I would say.
And is that true with males and females?
For the military, for me in the Army, you're going to both, like I said, I've been to Egypt twice, I've been to Iraq twice, and I've been to Afghanistan once. And it doesn't make a difference which one of those countries. As a male, you don't talk to the females. Like in Iraq the first time, if we walked into somebody's house when we were searching it, you never went up and spoke directly to that man's wife. You spoke to the man and the man alone. It was an insult for you to speak to the wife. It was as if you were making some type of advance to the wife. You speak to the man and the male of the household, the husband, that's it. That's the way it goes. And you just, you know, that's their culture and that's what you have to deal with. And whereas in America, you know, it'd be nothing for you to walk into the house and, you know, you invite me over, Nancy, hey, how's it going, Nancy? And not even say anything to your husband. But you don't do that in the Middle East. That's not something you do.
How about in Japan?
As far as gender relations? It's funny, I mean, I think it's, people think of Japan, they probably realize it's very, what's the word, male-dominated households and that sort of thing. I do think it's changing, and it's becoming a little more westernized in that regard. I certainly wouldn't say it's as extreme as what John's describing. But most Asian cultures, it's usually a little more male-dominated. And a lot of them are in a period right now where they're going through sort of a lot of social, what's the word
changes.
I'm looking for? Social changes,
yeah.
That sort of thing.
Interesting.
Especially, I think Western media and Western society have had a little bit to do with that in some places.
Well, sure, we're so much more connected, right, through the internet even.
TV and movies are so huge, I would say. May have helped speed things along, maybe.
Let me see. Where do we want to go from here? Did you make any friends outside of the military? People who actually did live there?
Yeah, I actually have on Facebook. I friend requested the interpreter from Afghanistan. The last place I was stationed. His name is Wahid. I'm not going to butcher his last name, so I'm not even going to go there with that. But he lives in Austin, Texas, with his wife and his young daughter. He was the interpreter for us. Anytime I needed to do anything on the base, I was stationed in Kabul, Afghanistan, at KMTC, which is the Kabul Military Training Center. So it's the training center for both the Afghan police and the Afghan army. He was the interpreter. If I needed somebody, I needed to speak with somebody, or the truck drivers are delivering things on the base, whatever the case may be, or I was dealing with the Afghan, I'd go over to the Afghan side, to their barracks, to speak with the generals or whoever I would take him with me. But my friend requested him, and I talk with him occasionally. He's doing very well. He lives, like I said, he lives in Austin, Texas now with his wife and his daughter. And
he moved here?
He moved here, yeah. I knew that in 2011 when I got there. He was attempting to do that. He'd been an interpreter for the Army for quite a while. Actually, he probably suffers from PTSD too, because he was a interpreter out in one of the Providences there, and he was based on the discussions with him, it sounds like he was in a lot of combat. So he was dreading the possibility he would have to go back out there. He had seen enough. So.
Did you get to go to his home?
No, we.
Did you go to anyone's home?
No, no.
How about you, Brian? Did you get to go to anyone's home outside of the base?
Oh yeah, I lived out in town. One of the things I was going to say was, for a while in Japan, I almost felt like I was living two lives, where I had my military life, and which was very American, and we did all of our military operations, and I lived on a ship. That's a whole culture in itself.
Yeah.
But then living in Japan, I always tried to learn more about the culture. I had an apartment out in town, and I could relax. I had a lot of Japanese friends. I've forgotten a lot of the Japanese I used to know. I used to be able to speak a little bit, but I still have friends on Facebook, and it's funny, when social media became a huge deal, we all kind of reconnected again. Yeah.
What was the differences in, like, the architecture of a home, the sanitary conditions, things like that?
I mean, Japan is just like any, you know, it's ultra-modern city, but yeah, the architecture, it's been a while, it depends where you go, but the interesting thing about Japan is, you know, if you go to Tokyo, you will see modern skyscrapers, futuristic technology, and then the next street over, there's like a 1,000-year-old shrine, and there's people in kimonos. It's all right on the same block. It's amazing.
And didn't you tell me that the houses, the rooms were like a paper kind of a house?
The inside, yeah, like it's very thin compared to what we're used to. The building materials, even like the outside of the house, they build a house in like, it seems like a week, they just throw like, and I mean, I'm sure it's sturdy, but compared to what you're used to in America, the rooms are very small. There's usually not a lot of furniture. People pull out mats. They have little like tables on the floor. A lot of people don't have like standing tables or like full-size beds. A lot of people use like mats and rugs and that sort of thing.
Do you know why that is? What would be the reason for that?
I don't know the exact reason. I think it's just the way that it's sort of evolved over time, I would guess.
John, what about you? Going to someone's home, what did they look like?
Yeah, I mean, I never really went to anybody's home, and I can't say I never went to anybody's home. If I went into somebody's home, it was usually for we were looking for something specifically in Iraq the first time around. We would do searches of people's homes that we thought maybe the bad guys were in. Second time around, didn't really go to somebody's home. I went to their business. They were invited for a meal, and I sat down. It was different. As far as like the sanitary conditions and the structures that you see in Iraq and Afghanistan, didn't get to really see a lot of the houses in Afghanistan. Iraq, however, it's hot there, so everything's made of cement and clay and brick or whatever. They very thick walls that insulate from the heat. How do I describe the heat to you? Have you ever been to a salon? And they have those old-fashioned hair dryers where the ladies stick their heads up into them and everything. All right, well, go sit in one of those and put your face on it and turn it on high and then breathe. Try to breathe through that hot air coming into your face, and that's what it's like there. It's extremely hot. It's 100 and something degrees there or hotter, or can get hotter. It can be, it's been as much as, I think I've been in as much as 120. So it's very hot.
So they don't need any fuel to...
They have propane. It gets too hot. A lot of the houses have roofs. They sleep on the roof. They go up on the roof and they'll at nighttime and they'll stay on the roof and they'll build like a small like canopy something on the roof to keep the bugs and stuff away and things like that. But they'll sleep on the roof. Bathrooms, things like that. The bathroom in the Middle East, they're not inside the house. They're separate. They're separate from the house, so basically like the old fashioned here in the United States, you know, outhouse. Well, that's kind of similar to that. It's not a toilet. It's a what would look like an old fashioned metal bedpan that you would see in a hospital. And it's like that on the ground, and you basically you squat over it, do your business, and there's a hose there. They don't use toilet paper, things like that.
What do they do if they don't use toilet paper?
They have a hose usually, and they hose themselves off, and they looks like that. It's not very, you know, that's any house I ever went to when I was there, I never saw toilet paper. It's just it's not something they use. They've been using it for centuries and thousands of years, I guess. They've been doing it with water, and it's worked for them up until now, so that's what they do. And it doesn't make a difference, Iraq, Afghanistan, they do the same thing. That's how they do things. They cook with propane. They don't really need a lot of heat. They have these things, they call them swamp things. They're like these giant fans that they attach a hose to and everything. It probably puts like a mist that cools the house off. Some houses that I went to had beds in them, but for the majority of them, they all had mats. They have these foam mats, and they're like multicolored, different materials on the outside of them. That's what they sleep on. They don't have a lot of like table and chairs, couches, things like that. They're not, you know, for them it's a lot of sitting on mats and things like that, and that's the way they, you know, what they do there.
It sounds like you're both listening to both you and Brian, and in the United States we have a lot of stuff.
Yeah, they will give you, if you're invited into a house in Afghanistan or in Iraq, cultural-wise, things we were taught is, if they invite you, they'll pretty much give you, you know, that saying, they'll give you the shirt off their back. So if they're poor, no matter what, they'll give you everything they have just as it can treat you as a guest, an honor for them. It's an honor to have you there. So we would always try to bring something with us and give it back as well as a gift back. And because, you know, obviously, you know, if you saw some of the places or where some of the people lived, it was pretty bad. Afghanistan, we were collecting old newspapers and we were making them into blocks, kind of like a paper mache blocks, and those blocks were for burning for heating houses in Afghanistan. So we were actually taking those out to the community and giving to the people. Some of the they would drive around, they were going out on patrols, and they would go out and deliver them to the people out there, so they
heating
could
for cooking
heating for, because Afghanistan, and you know, contrary to what you're looking at, Afghanistan and Iraq are a big difference. Iraq is kind of leveled, you know, there's some desert that's going on and everything. Afghanistan, there's a lot of mountains, and it gets cold there, you know. So, you know, you're talking about places where, you know, Alexander the Great went and everything and set up, you have the temple in Herat. There's a citadel in Herat that they just finished rebuilding. That was done by Alexander the Great, and it gets very cold there, things like that. So it's, you know, they have different. Not that it doesn't get cold in Iraq, mind you, but it's kind of in different terms. It's like when I went to Egypt in 2004, I called my wife one time at nighttime and said I had to go get a sweatshirt on. And she goes, well, how cold is it there? It's 80 degrees. And she goes, well, that's not cold. Well, it was 120 4 hours ago. So we're just talking about a 40-degree drop in temperature. So, you have to put that into perspective there, you know. You know.
Ryan, what about sanitary conditions in Japan?
Yeah, I mean, Japan is for the most part similar to the States. It's, you know, we talked about the toilets, which was also a little bit different. But now in Japan, I think a lot of people use regular toilet bowls the way we do. But for a long time, people didn't sit down. They basically squatted over like a porcelain, like basically a hole, like a contraption, no part of your body touches anything. And that was, it was like that for a very, very long time. There's a story, I think this is like semi-true, I'm sure some people did it. When they first started bringing Western toilets over to Japan, people were climbing on top of them and squatting into them instead of sitting on them. I mean, I think you said something similar about the Middle East.
Yeah, in Iraq, Iraq or Afghanistan, when I first got to Iraq the first time, I was in Ramadi. And we had to get rid of our own waste. As I have some pictures here on I'll show you it a little later on. Make it put it into without being too vulgar. If you had to go number one for the guys, there was a tube. It was a PVC tube. Had a piece of screen over the top of it so people couldn't throw cigarette butts down it while they were going to the bathroom and clog the tube up. So if you had to go number one for the guy, that's where you did it. And then you went to the back of the building, and there was makeshift port-a-john set up there. And basically what it was is a wooden structure with you sat down on it. They were fancy, and they actually got a toilet seat they had shipped in from the United States. So you sat down on a toilet seat, somewhat comfortable. And underneath it was half of a 55-gallon drum chopped in half, and it was loaded with diesel fuel. And you did your number two into that, and when you were done, or when it was filled up, you had the illustrious pleasure of taking it and pulling it out and pouring some gasoline and burning it off. And everybody had to do that. It didn't make a difference what your rank was, who you were, whatever. Everybody had to take a turn doing it. So basically, you burned feces, so to get rid of it. But then when they got porta-johns, you could see that the different cultures, the, like I said, and they're used, they squat, you know, they into a hole in their bathrooms in the Middle East, and it's very foreign for them to see a toilet. So you would go into bathrooms or the porta-john, and you would see footprints on the toilet seat where somebody had been standing on top of it to squat to go into the bathroom. So it's a different culture.
Yeah, really interesting. What about, gender differences? And you already said, mentioned about not speaking to a wife, but, and you already said that it was a more male-dominated in Japan as well.
There's also a big difference. There, men and women actually almost speak different languages. A lot of words are like masculinized or feminized, right, or however you would say it. So there's different versions of different words. It's kind of funny for most guys, I guess. Like, we're out in town, we would generally talk to women, or most of the people I met, my girlfriend, her friends. So I actually spoke very feminine Japanese, which I didn't find out about until
so
maybe.
So you got into a relationship while you were there?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You lived there?
Yeah, I had a girlfriend I lived with for about 2 years out in town. But and it's sort of like one of the things that happens is because men and women speak different languages, I guess Japanese men talking to us, they can just tell. They're like, oh, okay, you learn Japanese by talking to girls, basically. But again, I don't know if that's changing or not, but it's not like French and Spanish where certain objects have like feminine masculine. Like, you would actually say different words. It's almost like two different accents, like a male accent and a female accent. And of course, the female accent is nicer and it's, you know, friendlier, whereas the male accent is more dominating and it's more forceful. My girlfriend didn't want me to talk, basically didn't want me to talk like a Japanese guy, because she said it doesn't sound nice.
Oh, interesting.
So that, yeah, I forgot to tell you that last time. So that's definitely a big gender difference built into the culture. No matter what happens socially, that's pretty deeply ingrained into the culture.
What about entertainment? What would you do for entertainment while you were there? That the culture would do.
Karaoke is huge in Japan, and you go to little private booths. Like, you can go with like 10 of your friends, and you get your own little room, and it's like all you can drink, all you can eat. And you just play like songs, and people get trashed and just sing with like their friends in a little room all night. But I'm trying to think. That was really big, and I think I told you, at pop culture, I was there in the 90s and early 2000s. Boy bands were huge, as with girls. Like, Leonardo DiCaprio's was huge. Titanic was like the biggest movie of all time over there. So I mean, that's sort of like the American pop culture that I saw.
It was infiltrating the Japanese culture.
Yeah, but the interesting thing is, they have Spanish movies, Italian movies. So like, you talk to somebody that talks about movies, you might get the impression like, oh, they just love America, but they really watch like a lot of different countries' movies with subtitles. They always watch with subtitles. They don't do dubbing. They want to hear the actual voices.
Oh. And they probably learn English better that way too.
Yeah.
Did you find that? Did you find that people spoke English?
Yeah, everybody.
As well?
Everyone studies English in school, so it's kind of like when you're in high school, you have to take English.
Yeah.
So everyone is sort of forced to study English, and most people take a little bit of English. So most people have a pretty good, can speak basic words. I mean, it's up to the individual how much they, you know, want to go into that. But most people will try to talk to you. Like, that's another thing where I said people are friendly. Like, if someone's working at a train station, you need directions, they'll really try to help you. Like, even if they don't speak English, like, they definitely try to engage with you.
John, did you find that was the case in the Middle Eastern
countries? I didn't really get to go out a lot. You know, like I said, if Egypt, a couple times that I was in Egypt, I got to travel different places. I went to Mount Sinai for biblical. It's where Moses talked to God, allegedly. That's what you believe. Went to Israel. Went to the city of Eilat, which is Israel's only port on the Red Sea. As far as traveling for like socializing inside of obviously Iraq or Afghanistan, you didn't get to really do a lot of that because obviously for, you know, you're a different environment, different place. So usually if you rolled outside of the gate in Afghanistan or Iraq, you were, as we would put it in the terminology, you were in full battle rattle. So you had all your stuff on and there was no, you weren't, if you were leaving the gate, it wasn't for fun. So.
But John, did you go into city areas or outskirts?
I went into, you know, as far as Ramadi, drove through multiple portions of Ramadi. They, Egypt, when I went to Egypt a couple times, I went to Cairo, and they have a nightlife there, but usually it's, I think it's based mainly on like the, for the foreigners, not really so much for the people that actually live there. I'm sure they have their own type of nightlife, but I never really got to experience that. They have bazaars and things like that, you know, or, you know, like a flea market, we would call it here in the United States. And you can go there and there's a, you know, and they're actually pretty fascinating to watch that the, you know, people are selling their wares and what they sell there and everything else. It's very interesting to see and everything. But it's not the same, you know, like movie theaters and things like that. And I don't recall ever seeing a movie theater in Cairo or anything like that. And it wasn't something that I noticed. You know, not that they don't watch movies and everything, because you can go to pretty much any, like I said, any bazaar or whatever you wanted to go there in Iraq or Afghanistan or whatever, and you could get a bootleg copy of any movie that was out there if you wanted to. You know, they like to watch movies and do things like that, but I think they're kind of more family oriented, so a lot of that stuff happens at home and everything, so they, you know.
Well, that leads me to another question, because you talked about electricity being different, and I'm not sure, Brian, if you saw that as well. Like, what about street lights and, you know, how is that set up? What would we see what would we say, oh, that's different if we walked into that country?
Japan's very similar. Everything is just a little different, but the same concept. You could actually, if you have an American driver's license, you can get a Japanese driver's license pretty quickly. You could be driving around in no time.
Do they drive on the same side we do?
I think it's the opposite side. I'm trying to remember. It's been a while. But you just have to learn the different signs. But it's all, it's essentially
the same thing. What about those countries?
I don't really recall ever seeing any of the Iraqi citizens or anything like that, or the Afghans guy, or the Afghans that had licenses and everything. What I did find kind of peculiar about the Afghans was I had the job of when I was at in Kabul, I had to like do the security for the base, let people in and out, you know, hire workers and everything, and they would bring up their birth certificates, and apparently everybody in Afghanistan is born in January, the month of January. No matter what the year is, they're born in the month of January. I'm not sure how that works out, but that's the way it is. Every birth certificate I saw was January, you know, from whatever date to whatever date and year, but it was always in January. And I asked the, and I could never get a clear explanation from the interpreter I was dealing with as to why everybody was born in the month of January. So apparently it's a big month for births in Afghanistan. But
electricity
is very, they run off of 220. We have 120 here in the United States. 220 is what runs your electric clothes dryer in your house. So, but everything's here in those countries is 220. If you ever go to Home Depot and you like say the electrician tells you I got to rewire your house, and you go in and you go to electrical portion of the Home Depot and you get a coil of wire to wire your house up. Well, there's like three pieces of wire inside that white casing, and that's supposed to wire a whole circuit into outlet from outlet in a particular room. They split that in half, or split that into pieces, and they will take that and they will run it up to a pole, and they will connect into the major line there, and they will run it down to their house. And I'm not saying they hire the electrician to do it. They hire in whoever's the smartest guy happens to be in the neighborhood, thinks he can do it, runs up that pole, ties that thing in, and runs that piece of wire down to the house. And I have some pictures here, and one in particular I was talking to Nancy about, I'll show you. There's a gaggle of wires that running from a electrical pole, and those wires, each one of those single wires, strands of wires, is running to somebody's house, and that's how their electricity. Electricity in Iraq fluctuated. Sometimes it was good, sometimes it wasn't. You see a lot of neighborhoods would pull together and they would have a generator and they would run a generator. So if they lose electricity for a while, they would they'd pop a generator on. We had a couple, when I was there in Ramadi, we had a couple, we stayed at a couple places. One of them was what they call ECP5, which is an entry control point. And we basically, it was a house we took over and we had to have our own portable generators because we had to run our own power, get our own power, because we couldn't rely on what the Iraq had. As far as the other, like, conditions, very few street lights, and sanitary, as far as the sewage and everything, was you avoided splashing or driving trucks through the puddles in Iraq and Afghanistan because usually they could be laced with human waste, and you would so you would splash up on you, and usually if you were in a Humvee and you happened to be the gunner, you were very upset when you get splashed, when somebody splashed through the puddle, because you got that on your face and all over you and everything. So you weren't really, they weren't happy about it. But different type of conditions and, you know, culturally and everything, you know, as far as how they're just very, not anywhere near the United States as far as that. You know, as far as the utilities and, you know, and the, how the houses and everything, it's just completely different.
Survive.
They survive. They absolutely survive. I mean, they're well, they've been doing it for thousands of years, you know.
How about education? Do you know anything about the educational background?
Right. Yeah, well, like I was going to say, especially in Japan, it's, education is, like, incredible, I think. I know they have a system set up where, depending on how well you do, instead of going to regular high school and college, you can go to trade schools, which is, some people frown upon that because it's you're supposed to want to go to college, but people go to these trade schools, which are supposed to be bad, and they come out with, they graduate with like a career at Sony, making like $70,000 a year, and that's not even like a real college or whatever. But the other big thing is, it's funny, once Japanese kids reach a certain age, they start going to elementary school, it's brutal, it's really tough, it's very strict. And then they go through high school, it's really tough. Their high schools supposedly are like our colleges, but a funny thing happens when they get to college, it's almost like it ends. I don't know like exactly what happens, but their colleges are supposedly, maybe it's like you already know whatever you're supposed to know. So their colleges aren't supposed to be that great. But for that reason, a lot of Japanese people come to America to go to college. Or if you're trying to, you know, make something look good on your resume, and if you can afford it, a lot of Japanese people come over here to go to college.
So it'd be like a continuation.
To continue, because if you go to a Japanese college, I think it's kind of considered, you know, like, okay, but then if you go to MIT, that's, you know, supposed to be so much better. So, and the other thing is, I think Japan actually has a negative population. I think the population is actually shrinking. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people overall, I think, strike out or look to move out at a certain point.
How about education?
Males go to separate schools there. They oh. Like, I remember specifically being in Ramadi, and they have they're going by the schools, and you would be told that that's the school for the males. I didn't really ever hear anybody mention the fact that there was a school for, you know, for the young girls to go to and everything. As far as, you know, the education, you know, some of the people I talked with, you know, dealt with some of the civilians that we dealt with, you know, buying things from on the local economy and everything. Some of them have education. Some don't. Afghanistan, they're bad. They have a bad, like I said, I was in the Kabul Military Training Center. They bring the Afghans in for recruitment and the recruits, and they were hoping for them to get somewhere above a third grade education by the time they left. Most of them could not read or write. So they were, you know, we're talking grown men.
Read
or write their language. You know, so we're talking about, you know, grown men here that have, you know, a third, fourth, fifth grade education when they're, you know, so they're not very, not the education is really not really looked at there. I mean, not to say that some of the men that are in the city didn't strike out and try to go to the university. I know my interpreter Waheed was trying to go to the university as well, but unfortunately, you know, it costs money like anything else, and like Waheed, he was making about $650 a month. That was probably about 100 times what the national average is in Afghanistan for a family household. He was making that just by himself. So he was, his money was going, when he received a paycheck every month, that money would go right back to his father. And again, in Afghanistan and Iraq, your dad, your grandfather, he's the boss of the family. That's who's in charge. They're the head, they're basically the head of the household. So money would go to them. Like he was, Waheed was actually supporting his family. He was supporting his brother and his brother's wife, his mother, his father, and everything with that money and everything. So he was looking for education, trying to get. I think he was going to the university, taking some classes towards the end before we left. But you know they I don't think they had the same type of educational opportunities in the some of those countries that we have.
Grocery stores, malls, that kind of thing. Would you see that?
No, you wouldn't see any malls or any grocery. Usually it's you'd see a market or whatever thing. It would be nothing to drive down the street and see a chicken and goats and whatever just sliced open and sitting there drip drying right there in the street, and then somebody walking up and, you know, buying a slice of goat to take home to cook. And they have their own, some of them would have their own farms and have small little gardens right there in the houses, and they would grow stuff and everything else like that. But there's no such thing as a supermarket there. There's small stores where you could buy certain things, but there is, you know, you're asking if there's a Stop and Shop or a Shaw's. No Home Depots, no Walmarts, none of that stuff. Those don't even exist in the Middle East. None that I've ever saw.
With you, I would think it might be the opposite because they don't have a lot of farmland, do they?
Well, no, well, they definitely have malls because there's Hello Kitty and Pikachu everywhere in Japan. But, like, there's definitely a big shopping center. But and I never knew this until the girl that I was seeing, we went back to the States and we went to a supermarket. And you're right, in Japan, the land is very small, it's very space conscious. She'd never seen that much product in one place.
Yeah.
And in Japan's, you know, one of the best economies in the world, but it's just not something that they have, all of that food in one place. They pretty much shop day by day. They'll go to little stores, fish, and you're right, meat is kind of a luxury for some parts of Japan. I wouldn't say a luxury, but it's not a big part of Japanese diet. But I remember we went to the supermarket, and she was like, it was strange to her. And you also think about waste and that sort of thing. So I think she sort of started trying to think like, wow, like it's kind of scary to see all of this stuff in one place. It's a strange thing. She never knew, and I never knew they didn't have supermarkets until that point.
Yeah, just day to day differences, right? That we take for granted and expect.
It's probably like America was a long time ago. Like, there's little shops on every corner, so it's kind of like when you're walking home or whatever, you can buy your fish or your rice or whatever it is.
What about the foods? What kinds of things were different for you eating?
I told you, I wish when I was younger, I was such a picky eater. I wish I wasn't, because now I love Thai food and I love sushi. I went to Thailand 6 times, and I don't think I had anything. Because I was afraid to eat anything. Now I would. Same in Japan. I lived there for maybe 2 years before I finally had sushi. Now I eat it all the time. But
come back to the States to have the sushi. You had to come back to the States.
No, I just didn't. I finally had sushi when I was there. And then the last year I was in Japan, I think I ate sushi every day. And ramen is not the ramen that we think of. It's very different. I love ramen. But it's like noodles. It's almost like a giant bowl of noodles with pork broth and all kinds of stuff marinating. It's really, really good. Anything in the ocean, like, it's some of the stuff is a little shocking for like an American from the suburbs for me to see like a whole octopus with like sea anemones and stuff like that. And I was a picky eater. But my that girl, her favorite food was. Is it sea anemones? The black things with all the spikes sticking out of them? Is that a sea anemone? The inside, there's like green stuff, and they make, with sushi, they eat it uni or something like that. That was like her favorite food. And to me, I'm sure it tastes fine, but it doesn't seem like something you would eat to me.
On the other hand, I would think there wouldn't be much seafood.
No, there was, they have a, you didn't really see a lot in in Iraq. Afghanistan, they would fish and get some fish from the river and everything like that. But usually it's the meats and things like that. The naan bread that they would have, it's that bread they have, we call it, would be pita bread, but it's completely different. You've actually had the real, that real naan bread, you're missing out on a lot.
Tell us about that.
It's, they make it, they bake it and everything, and the way they bake it, and they kind of stomp on the dough a little bit and everything, so you gotta be careful sometimes.
Stomp on it with their feet?
Yeah. You get you can get pieces of rock and things like that in because the way they cook it and everything, so they stomp on it like that, and it's very good though. I've eaten tons of it. It was really interesting. The way they cook their meat, I had some meat beef one time, and it was to me it was, I had it. Waheed brought it to me for wanted to treat us all out to some Afghan food and everything. It tasted like corned beef to me is what it tasted like, but it was really good. I've had chicken that they've cooked actually was when we were in Iraq and in Ramadi. There was a family that was having a wedding, and as I said, we had a entry control point, so basically you had the street cut off on two ways, so they had an order for the family to have the wedding party all congregate at the house. We had to open up the gates and let them through, so when we let them through, they brought us over food to actually eat real food as opposed to eating MREs. And if anybody's had MREs before, they're for Vietnam vets. It used to be C rations, which was in World War II, was canned meals that were all canned food and everything. For the now modern army or military, it's MREs, meals ready to eat. Basically, it's a very tough plastic bag and it has your entree in it, you know, maybe a vegetable, whatever the case may be, and chicken a la king, chicken, chili con carne, all of it. But it doesn't taste like that. That's what it says it is, but that's not what it is. They're disgusting. They have the heat. They have a heater thing that you can heat it up to make it hopefully taste a little, taste better. I've acquired a taste for Tabasco, Texas, Red Hot, whatever. That,
in order to hide the taste.
And I, nowadays, even at home, I pretty much put that on everything I eat now because I've been doing it for so many years. That's the way I got to buy tasting the food and everything. And I was never a picky eater, but you know, you get sick and tired of eating MREs. But anyways, they brought us food over in a big pan and everything, and we had rice and chicken and everything else on it. And I ate it, but you have to be careful because they don't have the same sanitary conditions. Like specifically, like when I was in Egypt on 2004, we were told not to eat any salads unless you bought a salad or any green vegetables unless you purchased it from a reputable hotel at their you know, like a Sheraton. If you went in the Sheraton and had a dinner at Sheraton, that's where you ate. Because everybody else would just wash it with the regular water, and you would end up with the dysentery. You would end it pretty bad. You would it would catch you real quick. Same thing with the water. Make sure the water, if they offered you tea or something like that, coffee, make sure that it's cooked really well. And sometimes that didn't even help. You think you're okay. You think you're okay, and you drink it, and next thing you know, you have the dysentery for the next 3 or 4 days, and you have to go see the medic and take Cipro or something like that to kill the bug.
One thing I wanted to get back to, you said that there was a wedding. What can you tell us about the wedding? Would it have been something like we would have here?
I never got an opportunity to see because it was, you know, their houses are, the way the lay of the land is, just about every house there has a wall around the house. Has a wall around the house and has a steel gate that's blocks off the driveway, and that's
would that be for the wealthy?
Everybody. Everybody starts off. They build the house. They get it going, and then eventually they put a wall around their house and their little piece of land, and that's the way it is. And they live right inside there, that little piece of land and everything.
Do you know anything or remember anything, John, about would they be able to buy their house, or they would have to build it on their own?
There was no, like, you know, contractors come in and say, you know, all right, I'm gonna, you know, I just bought this huge plot of land here, I'm gonna put up five houses. Now that's usually it's what happens is a piece of land may be plotted down or given to them from family members, and it goes down, and they just They just build a house, they get a small plot of land, they build a house, and they start from scratch. They dig it out, they dig the foundation out, they put the bricks down or put the cement down, and then they start putting the rebar, and then they just build it up cement by cement, you know, get the cement going, and eventually build it all up, and then they put their outer coating on the building. Like I said, the buildings in Iraq and Afghanistan are very thick for insulation purposes, you know, to keep the heat and the warmth in, you know, like for Afghanistan.
I'd like to kind of open it up to any questions. I'll come back if I need to, but what kinds of things are you thinking about asking? Anyone have any questions at this point? Yes?
I had a question about employment, because here you can have so many different kinds of jobs. What kind of jobs can you have over with your visit?
I mean, yeah, for me, I mean, it's funny, when you're in the military, I lived on a ship, and we traveled around. We went to a lot of port cities, and so other than Japan, I didn't delve too deeply into a whole lot of the culture. But I mean, Japan, like I said, it's definitely similar, and I think they have a leg up on us in like certain areas, especially like electronics and math and sciences and stuff like that. But like I said, yeah, Japan is very similar to what we have here. I'm trying to think if there's anything totally out of a totally different, yeah. But I'm drawing a blank occupation-wise.
I didn't really, you know, they seem to have the similar jobs and everything, but like I said, the education-wise, the opportunities for education, at least, you know, the places where I got to see it, I didn't really see a lot of the opportunities for people to reach out there. And, you know, you got to remember, I was in Iraq, and I went to Iraq twice, 2005 to 2006, and then again from 2007 to 2008. And 2007 and 2008 was a push where they dropped extra troops into Iraq and everything. So it was a lot of conflict going on. I didn't really see a lot of people, you know, striving to get for education wise. They were more concerned about surviving. Well, I think they were more concerned about surviving and just trying to make a living and trying to get by without getting blown up or shot or killed or whatever.
So governmental, and I don't mean a political comment here, but I mean, what would be the differences that we would notice in the government?
In Iraq, and I didn't really, but Ramadi was, they were the Sunnis. There's two different, you got the Sunnis and you got the Shiites. Ramadi was a big stronghold for the Sunni Muslims and everything. You had the sheiks or the tribe leaders out there that were, you know, they kind of controlled their little swath of Ramadi and everything. Afghanistan is definitely still a big tribal country. They have the villages, you know, belongs to a particular tribe or a group of people, and that's you know, you fall under their rule and their government, and that's the way things go and everything. And the people that I talk with, the friends of mine that were actually got the opportunity to go further out into the different provinces in Afghanistan, said that it was just a different, completely. They didn't really particularly care for the government that was in Kabul. They could really care less about them. The only government they really focused on was the one that was in that particular province, whether it be out in Coast or Ghazni or wherever.
Small
localized stuff. The tribal leaders are the ones that did it, and they're ones that controlled everything that happened in there, whether it meant building a new school or a new mosque or whatever. Everything went through them.
Brian, what about Japan? Is it a diverse
I don't know. They do have a king, but I think it's like England. It doesn't really mean anything. They have a president. I don't know much about the Japanese government. One thing I will say, though, as far as employment goes, I know a lot of the third world countries we went to, clearly there's very little money being generated within its own country. Everything, like all of the real money opportunities are coming in. So all of the cities that get built up along the coast or around tourism and around other things too, like sex, drugs, anything that takes money in any way becomes worth more than the local farming economy, that sort of a thing. It can be pretty sad, but it's tough. Other than Japan, a lot of the places I went to, like I said, I mean, as far as opportunity goes, they're relying on other companies maybe building a factory. Or something like India, where you have telemarketing is huge and these other things are huge, but then there's a shanty town right next to it where, you know, it's huge diversity between the rich and the poor.
Big gap.
I have a question for John, actually. Can you tell us about your visit to Mount Sinai? bit more. It sounds very interesting. And what was the name of the town by the Red Sea where it is?
It's called a lot. It's Lot Israel. It's their only major port that they have on the Red Sea. If you come from the bottom of, say, for instance, like I mentioned, Sharm el-Sheikh, they talk about where the plane took off, or the Russian plane. That's on the very bottom of the Sinai Peninsula. So if you move, say, just for geographical or directional, if you go north, you go up to Cairo, Alexandria, and things like that. So you go up there, you run along the along the Red Sea and the Gulf of Aqaba, and you go all the way up. You run into, cross over from Egypt into Israel, and then from there, you keep swinging around to the other side to come back. Say if you wanted to come back down the other side of the Gulf, you would be crossing over into Jordan and Saudi Arabia. Going up to Mount Sinai was. I did it twice. I did it the first time, and I did it the second time. Both times I went to Egypt twice. I went in 86 to 87. I was about 22 years old. Next time around I went there, I was 39. I turned 40 when I was there. So I was a little bit of a difference in time and everything. It was awesome. It was nice. I'll show you a picture. The second time around, we walked up the side of the mountain, and we slept overnight about 1,000 feet down from the summit of the and then we got up in the middle of the morning, and we had to put on little headlamps so we could see what we were doing, because we did it in dark, and we made the last 1,000 feet, and then I have a picture where you can see where the sun is just starting to come up over.
I'm gonna ask you kind of mosey on over there only because of time's sake, and we can still talk, right? And we can still ask questions, but just so that we get it up and running.
Go ahead.
What is death like in that culture over there? Is
like
it
funeral arrangements?
Well, how do they deal with death? Is it like us? Different?
They don't look at it like we do. I'm going to speak from the point of being a Catholic. We have a wake. Sometimes we have a wake, and then we. Protestant, and then you have a funeral service afterwards.
Okay.
They have the death, from the time of the death until the actual funeral, has to happen within 24 hours. It's like that. It's quickly.
How about Japan, Brian? Any mourning?
There's mourning, but it's.
I was just seeing if I was in the way. I do know there was one interesting thing. There was a ceremony. My girlfriend's grandfather died while I was there. And one of the things they did was, I don't know if everyone does this, I'm assuming it's very common, when somebody dies, you actually set up a shrine and you have the ashes in your own house, like in the living room. And people come and they can pay their respects and burn some incense. A lot of the people I worked with, Americans, were kind of freaked out by that idea, like it's kind of creepy maybe to some people. But I actually thought it was pretty nice.
Yeah.
And it gives people an opportunity to kind of come by and visit. And I do know, most Japanese people I've talked to, younger Japanese people, they wouldn't call themselves religious, but a lot of Japanese people believe in spirits, believe in ghosts. Other than that, I don't know much more about. But I feel that our society overall, we tend to not want to deal with death more than other societies, where it's a little healthier, I feel. They talk about it more, they deal with it more, my opinion.
This is the chapel that you were asking about. That's on top of St. Mount Sinai. It's up, and this is at the very top of the mountain. This is just right after the sun is coming up.
Just go wherever you're comfortable. If you're comfortable, turn around.
I'm just making sure I'm not in the way.
No, you don't.
This is inside, the actual inside of St. Catherine's Monastery. That's at the base of Mount Sinai. They have monks that are there. In the bottom, I don't have a picture of it. In the bottom of this monastery, they actually have cages, or like little cages, and they're filled with the skeletal remains of the monks, because there's no place really to bury them there, because it's so rocky and everything. So they would put the monks inside there.
Huh.
Again, not sure how. This is allegedly, this is the remnants of the burning bush.
Oh.
That's. No. again, I'm not trying to persuade people on their beliefs and everything, but this is what we were told when we were there, so we can take it for what it's worth.
While he's looking for more pictures, Brian, too, are there any other anecdotes or anything that you would like to add in here? You know, I know we're starting to come to a
close. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah, a couple more questions. Okay.
Brian, did you ever go to Okinawa, Japan?
Yeah, I did, actually.
Because my dad was a Marine, and that's where he was stationed when he was in the field. He always told me how life was so different in Okinawa than in other towns and cities.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, Okinawa, it's like a... I think Japanese people might go there for like vacation, like it's a resort. They have their own, they don't think of themselves as Japanese. I think the people who live there, they have a different lifestyle. Maybe it's like Hawaii, they have like an island sort of lifestyle.
Yeah, that's what you were saying, except it's totally separate from like the rest of Japan. Really.
Yeah, but my grandfather, who was in World War II, he spent time in Okinawa, and I remember I showed him some pictures, and he just kind of said, well, it didn't really look like that. I was there, but the thing, it was weird in a way because he was in the Navy, and I was kind of curious. Like I said, he was in World War II, so I was like, I wonder what he thought of how he felt about that. If he, you know, because some people have old grudges or whatever.
Yeah.
But he actually kind of said, you know, he was like, you know, I wish I would have gotten to see it the way you did, you know, like that sort of a thing. So it's just funny the way our cultures have. Come together.
Absolutely, yes, absolutely.
So this is
what do you have there, John?
This is the building I was telling you about, ECP-5. This is somebody's house that we took over.
Oh.
I'm trying to get you a picture where I can show you the what I was talking about. This is a typical house, what you're looking at.
That
the
looks
house.
Nice. Looks kind of fancy to me compared to this.
But you see. Some of the houses have beds, fancy furniture. Not every room in the house has it. These are the mats I was talking about, those things up in the thing there. That's what they sleep on. I don't really, not everybody has a bed.
Wow.
I'm trying to get you.
Yeah, that's interesting, John.
Wow.
Oh.
The wires.
So this is what I'm talking about, the wires, how they,
oh,
those okay. Those are the three strands that are inside a normal coil of a house wire that you use to wire your outlets up. All those individual pieces, and they just pull them out. Somebody climbs up that pole and runs it in there, and they run it down to their house, and then they provide electricity to their house.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. That looks pretty dangerous.
I don't know what else you guys want to see.
Weren't you going to show us was it the latrine or something? What was that you showed me earlier with the bags all around?
Oh, the pipes, the PCP.
Yeah. Can you find that? Yeah, that.
All right. But in the Army or terminology, we call these piss tubes. This is where the guys went to go. This is where they went.
Well, that's what they went in.
That's where they urinate.
Oh.
So you urinate into that.
Okay. Oh, I didn't have that picture in my
so
head.
So the screen, you can see on top there, the top, there's a piece of screen. It's taped over it. It's because... most women have never visited a men's room, but we had the opportunity. You go to the urinal, the guys would smoke, would throw the butts in the urinal and everything, and somebody here would have to fish them out.
So
obviously,
where would that go? Just into the ground?
It goes into the ground, but
uh-huh.
Obviously they don't want the filling up with
right.
You know, things like that. So they would do that.
A lot of smoking, John?
Smoking. This is the... this is a dining hall at Camp Corregidor where it was, it's very small. We built it, you know, plywood and everything else like that, but.
They were trying to Americanize though, huh? Looks like, was it Thanksgiving or something?
Yeah, Thanksgiving. So, let's see what else.
A lot of smoking in Japan, Brian?
Actually, do you have Japanese people?
Really smoke a lot?
We smoke more than we do,
yeah,
a lot.
This is the barracks where I stayed at. Actually, my room was right here.
Oh.
This is where I stayed in here. These are additional fighting positions in the event that we were attacked. Any other questions? Go ahead.
What about medical? Were there hospitals? And you said there wasn't much education.
They had hospitals, but they were poorly run, and for Ramadi, they had a hospital that we kind of stayed away from because, how do I put this? They would go into a mosque or to a hotel, into a hospital, and they would shoot at you from the hotel for what we call hourly rules of engagement. We were allowed to shoot at hospitals and mosques and things like that until somebody shot at us. We tried to avoid that because obviously, you know, that would be like somebody trying to come into my town and blowing up the Catholic Church or blowing up a church or a synagogue or something like that. We didn't want to do that. But obviously, they look at fighting the war, combat in a different way than we did. So then they would go into it and they would actually go into a hospital and they did that because obviously they knew that was they knew what our rules of engagement were, so that's why they went in there.
Did I see some other questions?
Yeah, they would have masses and everything that you go to, but.
Did you get the opportunity to go to a mosque at all?
I walked into a couple of mosques, or I did. Let me say, I walked to the mosque, not physically inside it, because you know they're not here. I just didn't want to infringe on their religious, rights and everything. So you didn't go in there. We went into a mosque, like in Ramadi. We went inside. We were going in there for bad reasons, because somebody was in there that wasn't.
Anybody else?
Mine's mainly towards Blaine. I like anime, so like, is anime really like as big as like out here and stuff and Japan and all that?
Yeah, it's funny because when I went there, this was in the late 90s, the internet, social media, it wasn't like it is today. So I had no idea what any of that stuff was. Like, a lot of really the crazy, colorful aspects of Japanese culture now, I think if you go online, you can kind of learn a lot about it. But I didn't know about that at the time. But yeah, they have whole bookstores just full of anime. It's really big. When I was over there, it was huge. And then I started noticing people over here. So I was starting to get into it. Yeah, definitely.
Anybody else? John, anything else that you would like to add that you haven't talked about? I know, John, you have a couple of pictures and books.
I got pictures. I got some different slides up in here.
Do you want to show us any more slides? You've got a couple of minutes.
Uh-huh.
And then Beth is going to speak as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm
but
here,
you're okay?
So
okay.
We're close to 1:45. I'm going
okay.
to speak after that.
Yeah, really interesting to see the pictures. Especially because you were there and you were taking them as just a regular person rather than a tourist.
John, I have a question.
Is it?
I do have one question.
Go ahead.
Do you feel that we have done any justice going to Iraq? Or
entertain that kind of a question. I'm sorry, but we don't want to get into a political commentary on this.
Why don't you just pick it out as a veteran? What is his opinion?
Yeah, we're going to try to avoid that today,
yes.
Just to look at the different cultural differences.
I'll take it, Beth. Politically, I didn't, my political, what I wanted to politically never mattered to me. I went there.
You just went there for
I attend, there was, when I left to go to Iraq for the first time, I just came back from Egypt. We volunteered, there was 10 of us from Massachusetts. I didn't care if they were a Democrat or Republican, Libertarian, or whatever. I was not interested in what their political beliefs were.
Neither
the only reason I went there is for those 10 people. That's the reason why I went there. I could care less about politically who the president was. Exactly. It was 10 of us. We volunteered. Most of the people I spent time with in Iraq the first time were all from the Pennsylvania National Guard. There was 10 of us from Massachusetts that volunteered and a few of us from the New Jersey National Guard. So I had no interest in there politically. I wasn't, George Bush or whatever, he was the president. That's great. But to be quite honest, I wasn't fighting for George Bush, I was fighting for the
enemy. I didn't mean it as that. I just saw it as a veteran.
Soccer stadium here. This is an empty soccer stadium. So they do like soccer. They don't call it soccer. They call it football. In this particular incident, this was in the, we were on a combat mission. We were there because we were taking a lot of activity and fire from that particular sector of the, it's called the Malab district of Ramadi. This is an RPG or a mortar strike on the inside the stadium. Don't see it there, but there was an Iraqi soldier there that was there previously. He got wounded. And this is the helicopter that's going to be picking him up, taking him to get treated. And I'm down here by this truck someplace right here with him in the back of the truck on the litter. That was like a 3-day operation. We slept on the seats inside this stadium here. Let's see if I can show you some. So this is right in the middle of a firefight.
Oh my goodness.
So we slept in between these seats right here. And if we didn't sleep in here, we'd be sleeping in our trucks.
Oh my goodness, John.
And finally, this is OP Hotel. This thing in the back here is a water tower. It was a known point for the insurgents to lay down IEDs, their hit vehicles, their destroy American vehicles. This destruction was done by the building, was done by a 10-wheel dump truck with somebody, the insurgent in it. He drove this up to the side of the building and tried to take down the building. There were Americans inside this building, American soldiers. The bomb was so big that there was a platoon of soldiers in there. So it was about 30 American soldiers in there, along with Iraqi soldiers, and it knocked everybody in the building out unconscious. But everybody in the building, that's how bad the concussion was. So this is what's left of the truck. And you can see what they had to do is right here. They had to put Texas barriers up, the Jersey barriers on steroids, and they had to put them up, and then they had to put plate steel in to hold up the building. We stayed in that building afterwards.
Oh my goodness.
We, chain link fences you see hanging from it is to prevent RPG, which are rocket propelled grenades, from being fired into the building. They get caught up inside the chain link fence and blow up. Or they just get caught and not blow up, but they wouldn't go inside the building. So
you put up the chain link fence?
No, other Americans did. So the engineers probably came in and did it, and they, I got other things up here, some pictures. I got a picture of myself and some of my friends that went to the mosque in Cairo. Didn't actually go inside, but outside we had a lot of the tourists go, and I got an opportunity to visit the pyramids twice, walk inside the pyramids. It's actually an incredible experience if you ever get an opportunity to do it. But like I said, been my Mount Sinai, St. Catherine's Monastery, so it's actually some pretty interesting places.
And we invite anybody to come on up and take a look at those if they want to. Right?
Yeah.
I'm gonna bring this to an end unless there's anything else that you'd like to add, because it's been wonderful to hear you speak. So very grateful for your time and energy and reliving what you went through and what you saw there. Thank you for coming as well.
Yeah.